Please welcome Roger Waters.
Nice to meet you. You can sit here.
Thank you.
Welcome.
Thank you.
We persuaded the Prime Minister of Norway here to sit for like 10 more minutes because she's such a fan.
Perfect.
Yes.
I love that.
It's part of my youth, you know.
I believe you.
Yeah.
I believe you. I get told that quite a lot.
Yeah. Everybody in my age has part of all the parties in our teams.
Well, I've been sitting backstage watching all of this, so I'm a big fan of yours now.
Thank you. Thank you.
And yours.
You grew up. I mean, we're sitting here with a couple of very powerful women, and you grew up among women, strong women.
Yeah.
How did that shape you?
As far as I am grown up, you know, which is always a moot point. My mother was a very strong woman, and I was very happy about that. You know, listening to all of this conversation, I've been fascinated this afternoon, but there was a certain point, and I don't remember exactly what you were talking about. I think it was about whether we accept the politics of our parents or whether something transcendental has to happen in our lives before we can join the human race and start empathising with everybody. Mm. My mother came from a very conservative middle-class family, and they lived somewhere in the north of London. My grandfather ran a company that, you know, they were middlemen in fancy goods. She trained as a teacher, and her teacher training was in Bradford in the north of England. And one day in that first winter, the snow fell, and she went to, you know, welcome the kids to school that day, and they were walking to school through the snow with bare feet, and it went ding. And she thought, this is something so fundamentally wrong about children walking to school. Mm. But, and it changed her overnight, and she started to become interested in politics. Mm. And in order for her to do that, she had to leave North London and leave the cosiness of her family and go to the frozen north, and she did. And she, obviously she told me that story, but she was politically active all her life from that moment on.
And in many ways, you have been too, and also you have this thing with authority.
Yes.
It comes up on every album.
Yes.
Something about that. What do you remember how that started?
No, I don't remember. I've no idea. But I've never been very good with authority, and so I was thrown out of college and things for asking questions. Something Timothy was talking about.
Before we continue, I gotta let you go because I get so many signals here that you are someone's waiting for you in another meeting or
yes,
something. I don't know. It's your schedule.
That's the schedule of the United Nations General Assembly.
That's
yes.
you chose that life.
And I enjoy it. Yeah. I admit it.
That's good.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you very
thank
much.
You.
I know.
Thank you.
Nice thank, you.
Thank you
so much.
Thank you.
Okay. And then we can continue. Okay. No, we got to talk about your tour because it's a tour that's coming to Norway and Sweden as well.
It is.
The next summer. Yep. But it's called Us and Them, and that's a title that. It's very well known because it's one of your classics.
Yeah.
Why is it relevant now?
It's a song from Dark Side of the Moon, which was from 1973. There's a line in it which goes, with, without, and who'll deny that's what the fighting's all about? And the answer to that question is almost everybody. Mm. Almost everybody thinks that the wars that we are subject to constantly now, we live in a state of perpetual war, which by a lot of people in the United States has been accepted. They think it's okay because they think they're fighting terrorists. That's what they think. That's not why we're in a state of perpetual warfare, in my view. And we know that all human beings descended from the first Homo sapiens, and who were from Africa, and that we have spread out over the globe into different parts of the globe. And in consequence, we all, some of us look different than others. This is because of weather and, you know, and stuff that's happened over the last time. But we all carry the same DNA. We are all related one to another. Wherever we're born, whatever our religion is, whatever our ethnicity, whatever our colour, whatever our sexual preferences, whatever, we are brothers and sisters. And that's what...
I'm getting curious because you are so engaged in politics. Was it like that back in the days? Was it like that with the band Pink Floyd? Did you have political discussions? Are the other guys like that? Or was that something that was your thing?
A couple of them were like that up to a point, you know, but beyond that point... No, we didn't have political discussions about things, really.
So it wasn't like you only ranting and, and they...
I think you mean writing when you say ranting. But, yeah, I think so. No, there wasn't much of that going on, which is interesting because a lot of people who claim to be Pink Floyd fans, not a lot, but some of the trolls I get on my Facebook page are going, how dare he, the politics, the anti-Trump stuff in his show. I came there to listen to the songs. I don't want to hear that, you know, rock and roll stars shouldn't be political. They could keep their mouths shut, which is clearly ludicrous.
Are you a free man?
Yeah, up to a point, but only up to a point. If this machine that he's trying to stop with his Lemmy Duperte pamphlet there goes on trundling and gathering steam and gathering pace, and if we don't all stand up in the street looking at each other eye to eye and say, no, this is not what we want. We want something more like Roger was talking about on that Swedish TV program, then I'm terrified that we could see it. It's the changes in the law, as I said before, that are the most fundamentally dangerous thing.
Can you also feel empathy with people that actually voted for Trump?
Yeah, of course, because a lot of them have got nothing. They feel defeated. A lot of blue-collar workers, particularly in the United States, feel defeat because they've seen their standard of living plummet. They no longer have. The dream is gone, the idea that if you worked hard, you could get a decent job in manufacturing or something, and that you could then buy a car and live in a house in a suburb somewhere, and everything was... It doesn't exist anymore. People live in their cars now, or the, you know, shells of cars in the forest.
It's kind of interesting, because throughout this programme, it has... I mean, obviously, none of you voted for Trump.
No.
I think that's... But I think from a Scandinavian perspective, America is now very divided. It's like you don't speak to each other. Are any of you close to anyone that voted for Trump?
I do happen to be in touch with a lot of people who voted for Trump. The most people in my family voted for Trump. The book came partly from going to Ohio before the elections and talking to folks who voted for Trump. It's also, I think, very important to see that sometimes they had good reasons for doing so, even if one disagrees with what they did. Sometimes they see things that are wrong with our country that we might not see, and only in conversation is that going to come out.
We're gonna wrap it up soon here. I just want to ask you, looking back, we were talking about upbringing, childhood. When you were 15 years old, what didn't you know then that you know now and you would wish you knew then?
Hell of a question.
Kim, could you answer that?
No.
Oh, yes, you're going to have it too. Yeah.
What did Kim not
know? You know, that's...
You must have learned something from life.
It's ongoing.
I'll tell you what,
it?
I have.
What
I,
you've I, learned is ongoing. That's what you learned. It's
this
ongoing.
This is what I've learned, all right? I've learned that shame is a terrible motivator. I was crippled by insecurity and feelings of shame when I was a 15-year-old boy. As many 15-year-old boys in 1958, were. We, back in 1958, sex, for instance, was completely verboten. You know, you couldn't... And even the thought of sex in any context was shameful, deeply, desperately shameful. So that was one thing. But also...
I think that's a brilliant answer.
OK.
Would you agree?
It's a tough age. Your hormones are going crazy. For me, I think that I was just starting to see that the world was a bigger place outside of my family, and I found that very exciting. And at this point in my life, I think I've come full circle, and I'm rediscovering what I knew as a child, which I find very comforting. Hmm. How about you, Tim?
I've had more time to think now. but one thing that I learned right around that time, which Roger has been reminding me of, is this. I was in a public speaking class, and I was very vain, and I thought I was terrific and all this, and I had a teacher who taught me, what you're saying is only real if the other person understands it. It's not what you say, it's your ability to communicate. And you can't communicate unless you see the world the way the other person sees the world, which is empathy. Yes. You can't talk, you can't communicate without facts, but you also can't communicate without empathy. And art gives us that, which is one of the reasons why it's been such a pleasure to listen to you.
Yeah. Are you nostalgic?
No, what, for those days? No. Yeah. I'm looking forward. As I say to my partner in life now, I say it to her often, we keep dinning it into each other, really, is that we have to stay in the moment. You have to stay as close to the moment as you can. And, you know, not worry too much about yesterday. Look forward to tomorrow, but make certain that in the moment you're looking into their eyes and that you're focused on love. I know it sounds soppy, but it's not.
And in only 25 years, there's a new album coming out. Thank you so much, Roger Waters. This wonderful time.